Ah, what a Picasso. Stick it on the fridge.
Don't touch that dial now. We're just getting started.
I'm here for you.
Squirrel Stapler is a game about eradicating iDubbbz's squirrel initiative, rounding up your game and then dressing it on your wife. Some say it's a fetish, but I say art is an expression. And because I was a good boy for working over 100 hours this week on pyrocynical videos, I was rewarded with 1 hour of playtime from Pyrocorp, and I decided to spend it doing whatever this is. Man, I love media ambiguity. Huh? At first glance, the game may look like oatmeal, but it's oatmeal mixed with bananas and maple syrup. It's got flavor and personality. And don't kid yourself, you're exhausted from those $70, 100-hour-long to-do lists. So, you play games that look like they were made in 1999 because you're not like other gamers. You don't even know what a FIFA is, so you qualify as cool. Squirrel Stapler is a game made by David. If you've heard of Iron Lung or Dusk before, you might be on YouTube too much. Basically, these games were made by the same guy. Your first impression of this game may be that it's some tacky shovelware hidden on a CD amongst 700,000 other Flash games, and for some reason Zoomer and Bejeweled are on here. Mom, no, put the wine away. Baldi's Basics pulled a similar aesthetic, a surface-level appearance of naive innocence, which quickly turned that expectation on its head. Booting up the game, all five of your senses are immediately assaulted just by this main menu screen. Yes, even smell. Generic guitar music repeats the same riff with an awkward gap in between replays. You abuse your eyes to stock photo imagery. This is a bitmosh nightmare made in Microsoft Paint.
What the fuck? Microsoft Paint sucks now.
A tool for budget game dev. It's true. Risk of Rain 1 was made with Microsoft Paint. Oh, you think I'm lying? Go look it up. I'll wait. Thanks for unpausing. Now you can trust me.
You didn't pause the video, did you?
From the low resolution quality of the next level screen, the stretched mirrored squirrel of the committing sin screen, David took conscious effort to make something this perfectly bad. His research definitely consisted of playing bargain bin games from the 90s, which offers the additional stinging reminder that aging exists. It even says all the way down here, zoom in right there. A bargain bin hunting game by David Szymanski. David Davinci? It's a meta joke too because this game was paired in the Dread X Collection 2, a bunch of short horror games slapped together within 10 days.
Holy shit, 10 days!
Bargain bin games, or shovelware games, are low quality titles made up of cheap assets with the sole purpose to take your money and sanity with it.
You got dogs.
The graphics. That's really what this is all about.
The primary prey are typically people who are video game illiterate, unsuspecting buyers like grandpa and grandma. They come packaged in many coats of Trojan horses, movie video game adaptations, sports games, including this weird obsession with hunting games, which we're playing.
I know!
Another miss!
You kill the deer.
At some point, you will have mostly seen these point-and-click mystery games in a computer store like Curry's or Best Buy for my Americans, but most shovelware will be bundled with other games on a singular disc. However, some are standalone.
See, why would I buy CSI, which is one standalone game, when I can buy 1,000 games and 1,000 games volume 2? Do the math, that's like at least above one game.
In reality though, the quantity of games that they claim to have is actually a fraction of what they really hold.
Well, I mean, there's only 145 games on the whole disc. You're looking at every single game.
Obviously, that's the surface level appearance Squirrel Stapler is lapping as. It doesn't try to hide what type of game it is, because the first thing you see is the severed body of your wife. She was beautiful, but now, flies made her ugly.
Go on, get the fuck out of here.
Yeah, just throw a couple gray squirrels on there to make it beautiful, and fix the decline of the red squirrel population. Your house is an empty, desolate pit with only a bedroom, a dining room, and a few plates. There's a reading room with a blood-smeared ritual on the floor, and with every new day, a fresh passage from the Squirrel Bible can be read.
Day 1. Book of the Grove. Chapter 4, verse 1. Saith the goat of the wood, Thou shalt not staple squirrels.
Wait, hold on, I never said that. By the exit of your house, a piece of text written in environmental storytelling blood can be seen.
In 5 days, God is coming.
We're gonna have to use our rational thinking caps for this one. How can Squeezus be real if he died for my sins, but I'm still sinning? If you ever wanted to experience what it's like to hunt without actually killing an animal, well, here's your chance. The gameplay loop is simple. You're given a hunting rifle, a pair of ears and eyes, and God's given right to find these fashion statements. Do this for 5 days straight until God arrives and kills you. Not my problem. Additionally, outside your home, there's a patch of grass laced with fentanyl. Every morning, it kills some squirrels for some extra XP. Who needs a squirrel snare when you have a meth lab on your front lawn? This game forces you to use your senses, a practice of exploration and patience through intuition. Look, there's one over there! He's gone. This game has a sight and sound meter. If you run, you're loud, and if you're stood up, you are visible. Two notes found outside your home provides instructions on how to hunt. The tip of the day, which gets updated, yes, by every new day, and some basic hunting tips, saying to stay low and to stay quiet. This, at first, makes you patient, so you begin to listen and slow down. The game will play many sounds at you. You'll hear a variety of bird squawks, or what seems to be an elk screaming. These are designed to throw you off course, pull your attention away, and distract you. For now, you've been primed to listen to sounds, but you have yet to know what to listen for. So you investigate and find nothing. But eventually, you hear little rustling sounds, maybe even a squeaking noise, which means there's a little squirrel here. And then by day two, you then hear a big rustling sound, meaning it's a big squirrel. By day three, the sound of, which means you should, you know, leave. Oh, you can't run because you lost the life lottery being born American?
What? Why do you all drive trucks here?
Well, near your shack, you can find a can of Monster Energy, probably used as a makeshift bong, but there's still some juice in there. This actually makes you run faster for like 30 seconds, but it's great for escaping squirrels gone DEFCON 1. The initial tutorial note suggested playstyle sets up false expectations of tactical and methodical ways for traversal and play. It tricks you because when you play the next day, continuing to practice this method, a subversion of expectation just fucking explodes in your face. Additionally, the energy drink item completely undermines the gameplay loop of being patient and watching your visibility meters. They aren't single use, not despawning, so you can spam them like the caffeine-dependent young adult you really are. The map is big and you move so slow, so it's just more efficient to drink the can of battery acid and run around like a crackhead. You can catch up with and kill the squirrels before they even know that you exist. You might miss a few shots and run out of ammo, but thankfully rednecks just leave infinite piles of ammo around. The only thing you really have to worry about in this game are the combustible squirrels, ghosts, and crackheads. David also deploys another clever little trick here. By now, you are used to the library of stock sound effects that play throughout the forest. The birds, the elk, the watermark. So much so that any other abnormal sound that isn't a squirrel squeaking or moving won't catch your attention anymore because you're so focused on your game. And this is where you've made yourself vulnerable. See, if you had known what the sound was, you would have been more cautious. But your brain had been fine-tuned to tune all other sounds out. The sound this squirrel made this far into the game could not have been abnormal, as enough time has passed for the abnormal to become normal. It's a beautiful use of deception. Initially, the sounds can be disorientating, leading you to unlikely places. You do have a map and compass, but the only thing you use it for are the points of interest. The home we use as a safe space to just completely plaster our wife and squirrels, but the flies are still there anyway, so unlucky. But the other two places, the radio tower and the reporter's notes, or the reporter's den, these locations have notes that tell two different stories. The reporter's notes is about someone who's sending reports of this forest to someone, something, or anyone. At first, everything is normal. As days go by, abnormal tracks begin to appear, a byproduct of your actions in the forest, signs of God angered by the squirrels that hath been stapled. Squirrel bodies are found to be mangled and left in front of the reporter's base, by an animal or something? The radio tower is home to pages that tell a story about a painter called The Lady. The story is called The Lady, not The Painter. The story of The Lady is very on the nose, being this parallel story to the events that are happening in the game. The painter lives in a forest, and whoa, we're in a forest. He's painting a beautiful woman, and whoa, we're painting a beautiful woman, but ours is abstract. In this story, with a swish and a flick, the artist's painting comes to life. But oh no, he forgot the bottom half, so the woman is screaming. So we'll just do, right. So how much protein would this have? So in the story, the artist turns the body of his painting into a stew and dies from poisoning. And without being subtle at all, the story literally ends by saying, "Art will eventually destroy the artist." Art killing the artist can mean many things. You interpret it how you want. The story of the lady here is parallel to that of our character. The art that killed him is the same art that will eventually kill the player. But this to me is something more, like an unhealthy obsession in pursuit of perfection. Like how I had to come into a Japanese recording studio to redo this whole fucking video because I instead, the first time, recorded it in a fucking net cafe and the quality sucked. Rather than letting go of an imperfect piece, moving on to the next stage of an artistic endeavor, the artist facilitates a toxic relationship with his work, pursuing perfection in a restless effort to fine-tune every minute detail, spending hours or days on end. The end result is an aged soul with a stubborn heart that wasted so much time away to create something so impossibly attainable. An artist can never peak in his ability, thus he will always be dissatisfied with his works, a defeated version of himself, inside, a dead artist. He wanted to make something that was ugly, beautiful. Of course, that's just an interpretation. You can draw many meanings from the open-ended phrase of art killing the artist. Commodification of art is a big one.
Are you on TikTok?
A belief that when an artist creates to solely sell or to become popular, the art is killed. Which means a lot of YouTube videos were dead in the grave before they even reached the publish page. The art is built off of the foundation of money in mind. Henceforth, any emotion, artistic ability, or effort is persuaded by extrinsic incentives. So how does this tie into the pro-antagonist of our game? God kills him at the end. He just shows up and says, yo, you're dead. In an effort to make our wife beautiful, our art piece, we angered God. Thus our art is the cause of our death. But every day that passes by, things begin to get weird. I mean, we already know that. This triage of pages you find in this game begin to recognize you, seeming to target you exclusively. The story of the lady, as we already mentioned, is half parroting the plot of the game, minus the eating leftovers part, which is very economic, by the way. In the Book of the Grove, by verse 2, it already acknowledges what you're doing, and if not that, your character is doing everything in his power to go against this goat of the wood, all just to anger an all-mother. What with this deliberate ritual sigil on the floor and all.
Chapter 4, verse 2. For the bushy tail is righteous in the all-mother's sight, and the chattering voice divine. Should that which is divine be adhered to that which is not divine? By no means.
What, this isn't divine to you? You wouldn't say that if it was a Banksy. I mean, even by verse 5, the pages are less than subtle about being direct.
Chapter 4, verse 5. And I say unto you, in those final days the groves will bend in agonized worship, and the nutless man will be judged with his own industrial penetration and godless adhesion. So the stapler will become the stapled.
The game is called that.
The reporter's notes take an instant turn. On day 4, it displays worries of an entity finding its way impossibly inside this concrete wall. It's looking for the writer's brain, but it can't at first because their brain is hidden inside a skull. What? Don't look at me. Then suddenly, mid-writing, it's as if the worries were confirmed, because the note suddenly targets you, the player.
When my brain is taken, I will come for you. I will break you open. I will take yours instead. I'm in the shadows now. I'm seeing you, coward. You're already stretched apart into pieces. Your head is already twisted off the spine.
Please disregard previous reports. Everything is quiet. After being fully possessed, this thing attempts to subvert any and all suspicion away. Anyway, with my wife put together in a cloak of beauty, it's finally day 5, and I'm supposed to link up with God today, but I think he flaked on me. All he gave me was this piece of paper, but you know, a text would have been nice. God, where is he? Anytime now. In conclusion, Squirrel Stapler is a game that sets up false expectations and turns its own rules against you. David has done this before in games like Iron Lung with that big eye reveal and the choke points. However, Squirrel Stapler's story is not as deep as Iron Lung or Dusk, but that doesn't disregard the quality of the game or its story by any means. It's a good one-hour goofy experience that parodies a bargain bin game. Also, lobsters. But you won't try this for yourself anyway, will you? You already watched Markiplier play it.